Yes, our God is awesome. Praise the Lord. This is the spring season of the year, and boy, a lot of pollen is out there. I just discovered yesterday that what I thought was a head cold was actually allergy problems. Thanks to Pastor David Russell, who diagnosed me yesterday. We had a meeting, a men's ministry meeting, and I was telling the men that I had a head cold for about 7 days, and that's unusual. Head cold normally lasts me 3 days. And then my voice was changing. So Pastor David said, well, maybe you got allergy problems. So I came home and I consulted my wife, Jan, who's an expert in allergy. Told her the symptoms, and guess what? I have allergy problems. Well, that's a sort of mixed blessing. At least it wasn't a head cold. But now I got allergy problems. So if you hear my voice cracking or changing, it's allergies. There's nothing that I can do about that, I learned. But what can you say? You got to get your trials from somewhere, right? What did Jesus say? He said, in this world, you're going to have trouble. You think he was lying? No. I mean, you got to have trials from somewhere. I don't care what you're doing, how good you are, how pious you are. You're going to have some trials. In this world, you're going to have tribulations. So now, here we go with this type of the season. A great season for us because this is the Holy Week. This is Palm Sunday, you know, and this is a great time for us Christians. There are a little over 2 billion Christians in the world, and we come together at this time of year. This time of year has a very special meaning for us because we come together to commemorate what our Lord and Savior did for us some 2,000 years ago. And what Jesus did for us, we celebrate the life, the death, and the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and all of us who can come together, not just here in the United States, but around the world. And I say those of us who can because Christianity is illegal in some countries around the world. So Christians can't come together. In other countries, they are persecuted, so they have to have any gatherings below ground, so to speak. They have to hide and have their gatherings. So we here in the Western world are still blessed that we can convene together. At least we still have that freedom somewhat, even though that's being challenged each and every day. So we come together during this time of year, and today we are particularly celebrating Palm Sunday. And today we're going to find out what Palm Sunday was all about, how it came about, and look at the events that occurred on that Sunday. And we're going to see what we can learn as a result of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. So let us first go before the throne of grace in prayer. Father in heaven, we humbly bow before you here this morning in the name of Jesus. And we are so grateful that you blessed us that we can come together to commemorate what our Lord and Savior did for us some 2,000 years ago. And Lord, we are just asking that you will bless this message, help it to go forth with power and might, help it to glorify you, and bless us all, Lord, that we will benefit significantly from this message. We ask that you will move me out of the way, Lord, and speak to all of us through me. Use me as an instrument in your hands. Help me to decrease as you increase, Lord. And so your word go forth with power and might. We ask that you bless the transmission, the video, the audio, and help it to be a blessing to all of those who are here in the sanctuary with us today and those who are viewing on our social media platforms. So we commit this meeting into your precious hands, and we thank you, pray to you, and ask it all in the mighty name of Jesus, and we say amen. One of the most important events that ever happened in the history of mankind was the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. The coming of Jesus Christ changed everything in the world, not just for Christians, but for non-Christians as well. Jesus Christ changed the way we live. He changed the family structure. He changed the way women and children ought to be treated, how husbands ought to treat their wives, how wives ought to be submissive and to treat their husband. By the way, they're submissive to each other. So you know that sometimes people get that a little bit mixed up. think that only the man has the power in a marriage, but it's actually, the scriptures tell us to be submissive to one another, submit yourself to one another. But Jesus changed, all of this is a result of what Jesus did. He changed the medical system and the health system, he changed the science system, he changed the literally everything that we do, economics and finances, he changed all of that. All of our lives in this Western world is affected by what Jesus did, by Jesus coming. And as I said, not just for Christians, but for non-Christians as well. But for us as Christians, it changed our life significantly. We went from a life of sin to a life of worship and praising our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We came out of a life of sin to accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. And we are heaven bound now. We don't worry about hell anymore. We came from a life of sin to learn to love the Lord, to love each other, support each other. We came from a life of sin and we try to evangelize others, let them know about the saving grace of Jesus Christ. Let them know that God wants them to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. 2 Peter 3 and verse 9. He changed everything in our lives. And this was a good thing, a wonderful thing, a marvelous thing. All of this came about as a result of the coming of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Well, then, it's no wonder that we make such a hullabaloo, we make such a big fuss about Jesus coming to earth on Palm Sunday. So just what is Palm Sunday is all about? What is it about? And what happened during that period of time on Palm Sunday? Well, actually, it started about 2,000 years ago when Jesus and his disciples were on their way to Jerusalem to prepare for the Passover. And Jesus pulled two of his disciples aside. He said, I got something for you guys to do. I want you to come with me for a moment. And I got something for you to do. So let's just look at that for a moment. Thank you, honey. Let's just look at that and see what happened. Let's go to the scripture and see what happened in this event. This is Matthew's gospel. And Matthew wrote this about 50 to 55 AD. He wrote to the Jewish Christians about 2,000 years ago. And here's what happened during that time when Jesus first made his entry to declare for the first time officially that he is the Lord and Savior of the Jewish people and to us, the whole world, us as Christians. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away. This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. So the prophet had prophesied this event. Say to the daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you gentle and riding on a donkey and on a colt, the foal of a donkey. So this was prophesied to happen. The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. So they were giving them this grand old welcome entrance. Some of them cut branches. In John's gospel, it said that there were palm branches. So this is where we get the Palm Sunday from. This is where the name come from. While others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. They were actually welcoming him, rolling out the red carpet is what we would say today. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, who is this? The crowd answers, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. And this is one of the few prophecies about Jesus in the Bible, or stories about Jesus in the Gospels, that are covered by all four Gospels. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John covered this story, and some of them would tell some parts of it, some would tell other parts of it, and this is what you would expect, of course. Some people say, well, that proves that the Gospels are just phony and the Bible is not true, because you got Matthew saying this, Mark saying this, and Luke and John saying something else. Well, actually, this is actually proof that the Bible is true, because this is precisely what you would expect when you have several different people observing the same event, and it will tell you a story about it. Some are going to miss some points, but others will keep up on that same point and miss some other points that one of the others pick up. So you have to read the Gospels in their totality, the entire four Gospels, to get the full picture. Like Matthew here mentioned that they cut leaves. John Gospel said they were palm leaves. So Matthew missed that part. John picked it up. So this is actually verification that the Bible is accurate. The Bible is true, because this is. If they had said the exact same thing, then we would think of a conspiracy. Hey, these guys got together. They schemed on precisely what they were going to say. So something is wrong here. But God did this deliberately. Remember, God is omnipotent. He's omniscient, and he has all the power. He's the one that led these men to put these scriptures together, led Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, what they should write, how they should write it. They were carried along or moved along by the Holy Spirit as they wrote these. So God made sure that we know that the Gospels are authentic, they are valid, they're absolutely true. We could be completely relied upon them because of the way God did this. Besides, this is the Word of God, so we know that the Word of God is infallible, indestructible, and it's everlasting Word of God, and it is the truth. But this Palm Sunday actually started about 2,000 years ago. And as we see in this story here, Jesus and the disciples, they were on their way to Jerusalem. They had to go through the Mount of Olives to get to Jerusalem. And when they got there, of course, when they got to the Mount of Olives, that is, Jesus took two of his disciples aside, and he told them, said, look, I want you fellas to go ahead, because I got something for you to do. He said, I want you to go into the village. You're going to find a donkey with a foal. The foal is a young donkey, anywhere from 1 to 2 years old. He said, you're going to see a donkey there. The donkey's going to be tied. And when you go there, I want you to untie him and bring him back to me. If anybody asks you, what in the world are you doing with my donkey, then you tell them that the Lord asked for it, and they'll send it to you right away. Well, this is precisely what happened. The two disciples went into Jerusalem. They saw the donkey tied there. They untied the donkey. The owners came out and said, wait a minute, what are you guys taking my donkey for? Why are you untying him? They said, the Lord needs it. Go ahead. Now, when he said the Lord needs it, that didn't mean the Lord as in the saving Messiah. What that meant was Lord as in a teacher or master. That was sufficient. Once you say the teacher needs something or the master needs something, then that was sufficient. You go ahead and send it right out to them right away. So this is what happened in this story. They said the Lord needs it. They took the donkey back, they put their cloaks on the top of the donkey, put Jesus on top of the cloaks were like their cape or coat. Put Jesus on top of the donkey. Jesus went riding into Jerusalem on this donkey. As Jesus got into Jerusalem, approaching Jerusalem, the Jews that were there, they were all excited. They were so happy. They were literally thrilled to death. So they started shouting, blessed, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of God. Hosanna in the highest heaven. They were very excited that this was Jesus coming, and they took their cloaks and put them on the ground where the donkey was walking. They put the real palm trees, palm leaves in the air so that they could give Jesus this big, big welcome as he come into into Jerusalem. Now, they brought this donkey to Jesus, they hollered Hosanna, they were welcoming him, they give him a grand old welcome, what we call today, a red carpet treatment. They were really glorifying him and praising him and worshiping him. So, some of the people there, the Pharisees that were there, they said, wait a minute, what are you worshiping this guy for? Jesus, tell your followers to stop this foolishness right now. Tell them to stop. Jesus, let me tell you something. If they stop, the rocks are going to cry out. What was Jesus saying? Matthew didn't record it in his gospel that they said this, but John did, and some of the other gospels writers did. He said, the rocks are going to cry out if they stop. What Jesus was saying was, well, listen, I'm coming in officially announcing myself as a saving Messiah. This was a big event, a glorious event, a world-changing event. He said, this needs to be recognized. They have to worship and praise me. And if they don't, my Father in heaven is going to make inanimate objects like the rocks and trees and everything else cry out to worship me, because I'm coming into Jerusalem. This is what he was saying here. So disciples, they were just, Jesus just came right in and he just let them know, hey, this is what is happening here. The rocks are going to cry out. This event was so big, it was a prophesied event. Those Jews knew precisely who Jesus was. They knew from their teaching, they knew from their history that Jesus would come in riding on a donkey, as Matthew brought it in his message, in his gospel, that this would be the way that Jesus would come. And I want you to look at how Zechariah prophesied this. Zechariah prophesied this some 500 years earlier in his writing. And here's what Zechariah wrote. Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. Zechariah 9 and verse 9. So this was prophesied. Zechariah wrote this between around 480 AD, and this was prophesied some 500 years, let's just say 500 years. Now, those Jews knew this. They knew what the prophecy said. So when they saw Jesus riding in on this donkey, they knew that this is our Savior. This is our Messiah. So we are so very, very happy to see this happening. The Jews were in Jerusalem at the time. They had been out of Babylonian captivity for hundreds of years now, and they were in Jerusalem. They were somewhat sad because the temple was not the size of Solomon Temple. They were comparing it with Solomon Temple. So God sent Zechariah to tell them, said, look, you guys are having a little thing here now, but there are big things that are coming for you. Just hold tight. So that's when Zechariah wrote to them and told them, rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. So they knew that this Jesus was coming, and they knew that he would be coming in riding on a donkey. When they saw this happening, they said, this is it. Well, why such a big hullabaloo? Because Jesus was coming. You have to understand a little bit about the plight of the Jews at this time. The Jews were God's chosen people, of course, as we all know. God chose a certain group of people. When God created the world and he created mankind, he created nations, and he took one nation of people to be an example for the rest of the world. And these were the Jewish people. You see, he had Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Jacob had 12 sons, and those 12 boys became the 12 tribes of Israel. Today we call all of them Israelites, but these were the Jewish people, God's chosen people. Of course, they rejected Jesus Christ, as we will see in just a moment. But they knew, the prophets had said, that their Savior is going to come riding on a donkey. Well, they were very oppressed because they were under Roman rule, Roman oppression. And in 63 BC, the Roman general, Pompey, sacked Jerusalem, deposed the Jerusalem king. The Jews were no longer an independent nation. They didn't have any kind of freedom at all. They were under Roman suppression, and they couldn't stand the Romans. Their life was full of hardship and difficulties and problems and trials and tribulations. They were being suppressed. One thing you never want to do is suppress a nation of people. That they will rebel at some point. This will change. It happened during slavery, and that, by the way, all people were in slavery at one point or the other, all nations. We put a lot of emphasis on blacks as being enslaved, white keeping them in slavery, but listen, everybody was in slavery, including whites. Even the Muslims had whites in slavery, okay? So let's just get a little bit of our history right so we can get the right perspective. All nations and races of people were in slavery at one point or another. The Jews were down in slavery in Egypt. These same group of people. Of course, Jews are not considered Caucasian in the sense. They have all kinds of Jews. Jews my complexion, the Jews that are white. They didn't really know. In fact, there are no white people at all, really, in the Bible. All people were people of color in the Bible. People didn't become white until they left out of Africa, came up through the Middle East, went into Europe, and this was when God put DNA in every human being. They had to have vitamin D in their bodies in order for them to observe. They have to have certain pigmentation in their bodies. The pigmentation had to be adjusted so that they could receive the proper sunlight, the proper vitamin D to keep them living. Vitamin D is important for life. Okay, so when the people migrated up into Europe, they didn't get much sunlight. So the DNA begins to change. That's how people begin to change colors. So that's why you have some people with lighter skin and darker skin and so forth. That's when the Caucasian race came into being. But prior to that, there were no Caucasians. By the way, we wrote a book on this. There's a copy of it out there on the table if you wanted to look at it, but you could order the book. I'm not promoting the book or anything like that. We didn't write it for money. We wrote it because this was an area that people are so don't know a lot about. They don't understand that. The devil used this, of course, to divide people. That's what his role is, steal, kill, and destroy. John 10 and verse 10. So this is what the devil do. But there were no white people until sometime later on down the road when people move into Europe and the skin pigmentation changed to absorb sunlight, because in Europe, the earth was tilted a little bit. They couldn't get all of the sunlight, couldn't get the proper vitamin D. So God lightened their skin so that they could absorb from the sunlight the vitamin D that is necessary to keep them living. But prior to that, there were no white people. All people were people of color, like the people in the Middle East today. They're not white and they're not black either. So they're jumping up, hollering, oh, they were black. No, nonsense. There were different colors, different shades, but there were no real white people and real black people. That's a little side story there. Like I said, we did a lot of research on this and wrote a book on that very same topic, and I think I explained it pretty deeply in there if you're interested in pursuing that. But in 63 BC, the Roman government deposed the Jewish king. The Jews were living under suppression of the Roman government, and they knew that the Old Testament said they were going to have a savior. God said he's going to send a savior to save us. So they knew that was coming, and they waited. They longed for a savior. They yearned for a savior. They yearned for somebody to get them out of this Roman oppression. They wanted this so badly, and for hundreds of years, they waited, and they waited, and they anticipated. They wanted that savior to come. So when they saw Jesus riding, coming in on that donkey, oh, this is just wonderful. Thank God we are saved. Jesus is going to take care of these Roman dictators. He's going to free us from this oppression that the Romans have on us. He's going to get rid of these Romans, and we are so happy. Let's throw the red carpet for him. We're going to wave palm branches and put palm branches on the ground for him. We don't even want the donkey to walk on the dirt. We could put our coats on the ground for him. They ever just welcome him, because they knew now this is the time for them to get out of this Roman oppression once and for all. Jesus came in riding, and they were just waiting to see what Jesus would do. Jesus came in on the donkey, and he rode into the eastern gate of Jerusalem, and he dismounted the donkey. And what did he do? Absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing. Jesus didn't condemn the Romans. He didn't criticize the Romans. Jesus didn't even give a speech. He just got off the donkey and went into the temple. Well, the Jews were like, what? What kind of savior is this? I mean, we've been waiting for hundreds of years for this man to come. The prophets told us that he was going to come. He comes in riding on the donkey, get off the donkey, go into the temple. Later, he told him, say, well, give Caesar what's his. Whose side is he on? These Jews were highly disappointed, very angry, and they were just saying, Hosanna, Hosanna. You'll see a week later, they were saying, crucify him. You know, this is what happened. They thought Jesus was coming to rescue them from political oppression. Jesus was coming to rescue them from spiritual oppression, from their sins. This was why he was coming. They had it all wrong. They had the wrong idea. Anyway, Jesus came in. He didn't do anything at all. And This was on a Sunday, Palm Sunday, which started the Holy Week. Jesus was going to be crucified later that week on Friday. Well, by the time they got to that Friday, these same Jewish people were so angry with Jesus until the Pontius Pilate brought two people before them. It was customary during the Passover season to release a prisoner. So Pontius Pilate brought out Barabbas and Jesus. Barabbas was a convicted felon, if you will. He was a convicted criminal, already sentenced. So Pilate brought Barabbas and Jesus out, and Pilate said, which one do you guys want us to free? Want me to free? Pilate had the authority. And they said, free Barabbas. Well, what do you want me to do with Jesus? Crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. This was the same, no doubt. We can't prove it, but you could be sure that at least some of them were the same ones who were saying, blessed the Son of David, Hosanna in the highest, several days before. Just that past Sunday, they were hollering, 7 days before that, Hosanna. Now they're telling Pilate to go ahead and crucify him. What a sad state of affairs. This is what happened. Now, when they say crucify him, of course, we know what happened. We know the story there. We know that Barabbas was freed and Jesus was crucified. The Jews were so angry, so upset, so disgusted with Jesus Christ, they were ready for him to go to the grave. Yes, they didn't care about him crucified. Incidentally, right now today, the Jewish people are still under the judgment of God. Today, the Jewish people are still under the judgment of God. We'll explain that more when we get into Bible prophecy later on this year and explain why. But they're under God's judgment, just like the United States is under God's judgment right now, and we'll explain that more when we get into Bible prophecy. But this country is under judgment. You want to wonder what's going on and why there's so much hullabaloo and why there's so many crises? Don't look at each other and point, say, well, your people, who you like, put them in there, and this one and that. Don't do that among yourselves. You got to see these things from a spiritual perspective, a biblical perspective. Then you'll have an understanding of what's going on. Satan allowed these things to cause division among Jesus' people. This is what he does. But the devil is behind it all. God has given Satan reign. Satan is the god of this world now, 2 Corinthians 4:4. And this is why you see all these problems going on. But it is prophesied that God is going to bring all nations down who are rebellious and who do not repent before him. The United States have been rebellious against God for ever since the 30s, even prior to that. But let's just say the 30s. And you can see it getting worse and worse and worse and worse. Well, what is happening, that's not the worst news for us. That is actually good news, because the closer we get to the end time, we know that our Savior Jesus Christ will be coming again. This time he will not be on a donkey. He will be riding on a white stallion. We are going to be with him when he comes for the second coming. This is 7 years after the rapture, of course, because before we can come back with him, he first has to come and get us. So he will come and get us in what is called the rapture of the church. And we know that we are getting very close to this time when we see these things happening. Also, with the United States being the strongest nation, the most powerful nation in the world, the most blessed nation in the world, blessed more so than any other nation in the history of the world, when we see the United States beginning to decline like this, once the United States goes down, there goes the rest of the world. There goes the rest of the world, because we were supporting through our economic and financial system the rest of the world. We're still sending billions of dollars to countries right now that we don't have, but they crank up the printing press and they print money. Any first student of economics will tell you, you never print money. And once the government does that, it devalues the money that's already in the currency. And what happened is you're looking for a financial and economic crisis, which could come overnight in our country. That's just one of the ways the country could come down, and we are working on that very rapidly. Again, I'm getting ahead of myself, but we'll talk more about that. By the way, we wrote a book on that one, too. That book is out there. A copy of that is out there on the table if you want to thumb through it. You can also order that if you so choose to do so. But this is what is happening here. Now, those Jews, Jesus knows we're coming into Passover, as you remember. the Passover season started when the Jews were in slavery in Egypt, and they were down there under Pharaoh, and God told Pharaoh, look, I want you to let my people go. Pharaoh said, who are you to tell me to let your people go? Pharaoh was a powerful man. I mean, he was the Pharaoh of the Exodus, we believe, was a guy by the name of King Amenhotep II, or the third. One of those were the Pharaoh of the Exodus. So what happened was, Pharaoh kept them down there. Jesus started sending plagues. They sent plagues on them, and those plagues consisted of a swarm of gnats, a swarm of flies. He killed all their livestock. He put boils on them. By the time Jesus got to the ninth plague, Pharaoh still hadn't given in. He still did not let God's people go. And Jesus said, okay, fine. I'm going to send a death angel, and the death angel is going to kill the firstborn male of every Egyptian family in Egypt. And that's precisely what he did. The problem was there were hundreds of thousands of Jews, or Hebrews they were called at that time. They didn't be called Jews until later. But at that time, they called Hebrews. There were hundreds of thousands of them in Egypt, so what about their firstborn? Well, God told them, said, look, I want you guys kill a lamb, a sacrificial lamb, and I want you to take the blood of that lamb, put it on your doorpost, and when the death angel comes, he will pass over your house, your residence. This is where we get the Passover word today, where we celebrate Passover. The death angel will pass over your house. So this is how we came up with Passover. And God killed all of those firstborn Egyptians. When you hear firstborn, you normally think of a little baby. But no, you had some firstborns in their 30s and 40s. Growing people, firstborn. Death angel just wiped them out just like that. Boom, 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 just like that. You know, saved all the Jews, well, including Pharaoh's firstborn. Well, at that time, Pharaoh said, well, Lord, you got me. I'm going to let your people go. So Pharaoh let them go. But before they had got too far out of Egypt, Pharaoh said, let's go get them. He changed your heart. The Bible said the Lord hardened his heart. Does the Lord harden hearts? Is that what happened? Well, God doesn't come into you and say, I'm going to make you evil. To do that would make God evil. An evil act would come from an evil person. We know that God is not evil. So what did the Bible mean when they say God hardened their hearts? What it means is all God had to do is remove his protection from them. Amen. That's it. Just like us today. If we didn't have God's Holy Spirit, any one of us could have been Adolf Hitler. Amen. Right now, today. We may think we're good, but only good in us is from Jesus Christ, that Holy Spirit. That's what makes us good. But we are fallen human beings, and any one of us could do some terrible things if it weren't for the Holy Spirit. And God protecting us. He has his angels about us, encamped about us, protecting each and every one of us. And he gives us the Holy Spirit, which deals with our conscience and prevents us from doing evil, bad things. But this is what happened. But all God has to do is pull his protection from around us, and you'll be surprised at some of the things you would do. You'd be utterly surprised at how your mind begins to work if that doesn't happen. In fact, he doesn't have to pull his protection around. You just drift away from God a little bit in fellowship and see how far you... Next thing you do, you find yourself cursing and saying all kinds of things. Then you find yourself doing all kinds of ungodly things you know you ain't had no business doing in the first place. That's what happens. Well, God didn't harden Pharaoh's heart. What he did was just pull all of the protection away from him like that and let Pharaoh's natural inclination take place. When this happened, Pharaoh took out after the Jewish people. He took out after them, and we know the story of the Exodus is played many times during this Holy Week here from this day up until next Sunday, which is Easter Sunday. So, that's the story that we all know about back in Exodus, and we can read that story. We know about it from many stories and books and studies over a period of time. But this is where we got the Passover from, when the death angel passed over the houses of all of the Jewish people. So we call it Passover as we celebrate this here today. Today being Palm Sunday, the very first day of the Holy Week. What we call Passover. Now, we said that Zechariah made this prophecy of Jesus entering Jerusalem on a donkey. He made this prophecy some 500 years before. Now, this tells us a lot. It tells us, number one, that it tells us that the Bible is true because Zechariah didn't know Jesus from Adam. How did he know he would come in on a donkey? Not only that, he described the donkey, he said it'll be a foal of a donkey, which a foal of a donkey is a donkey from anywhere from 1 to 2 years old. Somewhere around in that, a very young donkey. Zechariah told him exactly what kind of donkey is going to come. 500 years before it happened. So that tells us right there that, wow, you're talking about the Savior, Jesus Christ. You got a problem in believing Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Then you just look at some of the prophecies. Jesus proved himself to be the Son of God in 3 different ways. He fulfilled a variety of Old Testament prophecies about him coming. He lived a sinless and miraculous life. And he predicted and accomplished his own resurrection. Those are the 3 ways that Jesus proved himself to be the Son of God. We will cover that more in detail next Sunday, which is Easter Sunday. And we'll go through those to show you precisely how Jesus did this. Because as I tell people all of the time, there's not one world religion on earth that recognized Jesus Christ as the Son of God. Some will say he's the Son of God, but they say he's not deity. He doesn't have the fullness of deity in him. It's just on a council there 3 days ago with a young man from a very big denomination, Christian denomination, and he had the same problem that they teach Jesus is not God. There's a very serious problem with that. Amen. If Jesus is not God, you don't have a Savior. Isaiah 43 and verse 11, only God can be our Savior. So if Jesus is not God, if you don't believe Jesus is God, then you don't have a Savior. That's one of the essential doctrines of the Christian faith, that Jesus is God. So you have to believe that. And a church has to believe that and teach that and to prevent being a cult. If churches deny one of the 14 essential doctrines of the church and Christian faith, that church is in cult status. And 9 of those 14 are necessary for each one of us to be saved. Well, we got a problem there. But we'll cover that next week, how Jesus proved himself to be deity, next week being Easter Sunday. And we'll have a focus on the resurrection, of course, and show how Jesus proved who he was. So this is very important for us all. Now, what do we learn from this triumphal entry of Jesus Christ into Jerusalem? Let me just say that while he did this, this was Jesus' official declaration that he is the Messiah, he is the Son of God, when he came into Jerusalem. He was declaring for the first time. Remember, in his early Gospels, he was healing people, and he said, don't tell anyone that I did this. Tell no one. Tell a vision to no man, and so forth. But now, he's declaring to the world. Why? It's almost time for him to go back to the Father. He's about to be crucified 6 days later on Friday. He's about to be crucified. So he's declaring now. He's carrying out his mission that the Father sent him on, and he's letting them know, this is it. I am your Savior. So when he rode in on that donkey, which had been prophesied by Zechariah and Isaiah and several other prophecies in the Old Testament, they knew exactly who he was. Now, the Jews were so certain that he was going to deliver them from political oppression, oppression from the Romans, that they didn't realize he came to deliver them from spiritual oppression. Jesus is more interested in the spiritual rather than the rather than the physical or the political. He's not interested in that. Now, let me just say something about praying here for a moment, which is very important for us as we pray. Well, maybe I'll get back to that. Let me just show you what do we learn from all of this, from this triumphal entry. First of all, the crucifixion of Jesus was not an accident. This was a prophesied, carried out, divine plan of God himself. That tells us then that Jesus Christ is the Messiah. And we'll, as I say, we'll see more evidence of that next week. But right from the prophesying of the donkey being tied in Jerusalem, the prophecy of Judas's denial, the Last Supper, the Peter's betrayal, all of that was prophesied. Some of it was prophesied by Jesus himself just before he came, before he died. But a lot of it was prophesied in the Old Testament. So we know right then that Jesus is the God of history. This is not an accident. This tells us, well, we know, we can rely on this. This is not a joke. This is for real. So we could benefit having that extra bit of evidence that the Bible is for real. You say, well, I got faith. I don't need evidence. Well, the Muslims got faith, too. So does the black Hebrew Israelites and the Christadelphians and a whole lot of others. Faith is fine. But if you have evidence along with your faith, now you're doubly strong, you see. That's why we teach evidence, because it's important. God tells us to prove all things and to hold fast to that which is good. So we give you evidence. Evidence combined with your faith will make you a stronger Christian. Anybody could have faith. You need a little bit more than that. Of course, without faith, it's impossible to please God. So you got to have faith, too, and we all know that. But evidence does help. It is important. God tells us to have both. Prove all things, and he tells us to exercise our faith as well as our faith. It's impossible to please God. Now, another thing that we could learn from this is that God does not always give us what we expect. That's one thing you have to understand. God does not always give us what we expect. Those Jewish people, they expected God to save them from the Romans. They didn't realize he came to save them spiritually. God is interested in the spiritual first. Spiritual first. Not just the physical or the political. Spiritual first. This is what God is first and foremost for us. This is true for us in our lives. If we are followers of Jesus Christ, for example, if we are Christians, and we are praying to God, and we are asking, let's say we're living like the devil. We're living a sinful lifestyle, and we pray to God and ask God for something. We should not be surprised when God says no. Why should he give us a blessing when we are living in opposition to what he tells us? We are living like the devil and asking him to bless us. What sense does that make? He said, what you receive, what I give you, receive it because you keep my commandments and do the things that are pleasing in my sight. 1 John 3 and verse 22. So we have to be living in obedience to God, or we do not expect or should not expect God to give us what we pray for. If we are not Christians and we're asking God for something, first of all, we are praying to God. First of all, we should be praying a prayer of repentance. So you can become a Christian. You can become a follower of Jesus Christ. Don't expect answers if you're not a Christian. I'm preaching to the choir here now, of course. I know everyone is here is Christian for the most part. God knows your heart. He knows what you are. He knows everybody who has his Holy Spirit, of course. So he knows who is his. But if you're not a Christian, the first prayer you should make is a prayer of repentance, what we call the sinner's prayer. You want to ask God to forgive you of your sins, and you want to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you vow and pledge to follow Jesus. This is Jesus, the written word of God. Jesus is the living word of God. We promise to follow what it says. So God does not always give us what we expect. We expect one thing, he's going to give us not what we expect, but what we need. Amen. We need Jesus. You can't get around it. Everybody's going to have Jesus at one point or the other, or they're going to hell, just that simple. At the name of Jesus, every knee is going to bow, and every tongue is going to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. You might say, well, wait a minute now, I see some people don't know God, don't know Jesus Christ, don't go to church, don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, never pick up a Bible in their life except to move it out of the way while they were dusting. Yet these people get all kinds of blessings. They seem to be living the best lives. They got the finest homes, the finest cars. They go on vacation all over Europe or South America somewhere every year. They're just living a good life. How do you explain that? Why would God bless them like that? Well, there is a long answer and there's a short answer to that. I can't give you the long answer today because it'll take too long. Amen. No pun intended. I'll give you the short answer. Many times, God does this in the hopes that this person will become guilty and say, God is blessing me so much. I just got to change my life. I'm going to start going to church. A lot of times, this is precisely what God does. The goodness of the Lord is to lead you to repentance. Romans 2 and verse 4. Sometimes he blesses these people to try to get them to come to him. Another reason you see these people being blessed like this, even though they are not Christians and not coming before the Lord, is because they are performing Christian duties, even though they are not Christians and may not be aware of it. For example, you got some people that work diligently on their job. They're very hard workers, not Christians. But they are reliable, they are dependent, they are competent, and they work very diligently on their jobs. These people are being blessed just because they're keeping a biblical principle. God says, you see a man diligent in his work, he will stand before kings. Proverbs 22 and verse 29. In other words, that man who works very hard on his job, who is reliable and dependent and competent on his job, he's going to go places. Whether he's a Christian or not, this is because he's following one of God's laws and don't even know he's following it. These laws of God are automatic. That's why you see some of these people being blessed, even though they don't go to church, even though they don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Also, everything that you get is not necessarily from God. Just because you see them getting a new car, fancy house, or some other thing that they want, like, don't think that's necessarily from God. Satan gives you things too. Remember what he promised Jesus in Matthew chapter 4. He said, Jesus, I'll give you all the cities of the world if you will fall down and worship me. So he could give you things. Jesus responded and said, it is written also that you are to worship the Lord our God, and him only shall you serve. That's in Matthew chapter 4. So Satan can give you things as well. Don't think that everything you get comes from God. Satan gives you things and use those things to destroy you. Fellow, you remember the story back a long time ago, Rodney King and the police officers were beating him up in L.A. out there in California. Well, King got something like $13 million out of the lawsuit from that. And then he and his family were going, whoa, God bless us. Yeah. King died a short time after that. Because what happened? Started using the money for drugs, alcohol. They had all kind of people coming out of the woodwork. First of all, IRS coming at you, number one. That's the first thing. They want 30% right off the top. But notwithstanding that, don't think you get a bunch of money that that's a blessing from God. Not necessarily true. Sometimes it is, but don't put your hopes. It depends on, you'll know if it's from God by how you use it. Anytime God gives us something, he expects for us to be his conduits, as pass-through entities to use that to help other people. Time, talent, and treasure. That's why you give it to us, to help others. You're not going to help others, you'll find out that you won't be getting too much more from it. But the devil gives you things. Sure he does, and he uses them to destroy you. But that same thing the devil gives you, God can use it to be a blessing to you. It can be the exact same thing, but for different purposes. Satan is giving it to you to bring trials to destroy you. God is bringing it to you to test you. The exact same blessing or curse if it's from the devil, but it's the same object. So but God does not always give us what we expect. He'll give us what we need. Always give us what we need. But never, don't always think that every time you pray to God, he's going to give you what you expect. Also, God does not always answer us when we expect. When we expect. Those Jewish people expected salvation from political oppression right then. Just like they expect Jesus, with what they expected was from political oppression. No, they didn't get it. They didn't get it when. Now, God has great plans in store for the Jewish people. He had the plans in store for the Jewish people from the time he told Abraham to go out and he's going to make them a strong nation. Sure, he had great blessing from them. But God does not renege on his blessings. No, he's still going to give them blessings. But the Jews went through a Holocaust. There's another one prophesied to happen before the end time. And Zechariah have another two-thirds of the Jews are prophesied to be killed. This is going to happen right now in our day by the way, and again, we'll get into prophecy. When we get into prophecy, we'll explain all of that and show you what's going to be happening with the Jewish people. But in the end time, the remnant of the Jews will be brought up. They will be in the kingdom. They are brothers and sisters. They go and accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. But that comes later. Those Jews back then, in Jesus' day, when he rode into Jerusalem, they were looking for it right then. Freedom from political oppression. They didn't care nothing about no spiritual. They just wanted to be back in charge again because they had an independent nation until General Pompey came and he got tore them apart in 63 AD and deposed the Jerusalem king. But God is not going to give us something when we expect it. For example, you might be praying for a job, a new job. You might be praying for a promotion on your job. And you might have been praying for months, maybe years. And all you heard from God was silence. Say, so what in the world? I mean, I've been, and you could be going to church and praying and reading your Bible and studying and fellowshipping, all of the disciplines we should employ as followers of Jesus Christ to help us build spiritual character. You could be doing all of that. Still, God doesn't give you the position. You don't hear anything. He said, I've been praying for a year and a half. Still nothing. What in the world is going on here? But there are several things that could be happening. God is always working things out for our benefit, for our good, always. It could be that you're not quite qualified for the position that he wants to give you. He wants you to develop more skills for us, then he's going to give you the position. Or it could be that someone else is in that position that he has in store for you, but he has to move that person out of the way first. Or there might be somebody in the position that he has for you that has a personality that you can't get along with. So he has to take care of that. Maybe he has to get you to be able to learn how to get along with everybody before he puts you in that position. God is always working. Everything's out in the background. We don't see him working. Sometimes we see some signs and indications. A lot of times he'll send signs to let you know, I haven't forgotten you. I'm working this out. Sometimes he'll do that, but many times he won't. This is when we exercise our faith and our patience and continue to be obedient. Because he said he's working all things out for the good of those who love him, those who are called according to his purpose, Romans 8 and verse 28. So we know that he's doing things, so we wait. Remember, he's conforming us into the image of his son. I mean, God is doing something. When we pray to God for something, he's not just working with us to answer that prayer. He's working with a whole lot of other people to bring that prayer into fruition. He takes that opportunity to bring in a whole lot of people. This is why when you get blessings from God, trials come with it. You pray for a husband or wife and you get married and you say, what in the world I married this fool for? Yeah. He don't intend for you to run from it. You stay in and let him bring you through it. That's how you build spiritual character. Another thing, don't ever be too fast to run from these things. Because he's given you an opportunity to build spiritual character. He's conforming us into the image of his son, Romans 8 and verse 29. He wants this mind to be in us, which is also in Christ Jesus, Philippians 2 and verse 5. So he's working with us. Stick in there. Stay with it. God hates divorce. He wants those people to stay together and work it out. And if you got Jesus in that relationship, it will work out, I can assure you. I don't care how difficult it gets. He is going to work it out. Well, the Jews didn't understand that at all. They took off. Said, we're going to get this guy. Crucify him, crucify him. That's what happens when you don't wait. You see how far you can drift from Hosanna, bless the son of David, into crucify him from Sunday to Friday, just that fast. Well, that's what happens to us when we don't wait, when we don't exercise patience. We won't say, crucify him. Well, what we do is walk away from the church, walk away from God, walk away from the fellowship that he has for us. We walk away from that. And that's one of the worst things that a Christian can do. Walk away from the church, walk away from the fellowship of God. Not necessarily just walk away from the church, but you're walking away from the fellowship of God. That's a terrible thing to do. Jesus said, any man who put his hand to the plow and looked back is not fit for service in the kingdom of God, Luke 9 and verse 22. Once you start on this Christian journey, that is it. You don't walk away because God didn't give you something or you didn't get a blessing. He gave you eternal life with his inner son, Jesus Christ. He gave us everything in Christ Jesus. When he sent Jesus, that was it. Don't worry about these material things. You got eternal security. You got eternal life. You accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, you just won.
Yes.
You cannot lose. It's impossible. Because you have just fulfilled the purpose for which you were created in the first place. We were created to have a relationship with Jesus Christ and to live with him in eternity. We are going through the sanctification stage of salvation right now. This is the sanctification stage of salvation. He's growing us up. He's shaping and molding and fashioning us. He's preparing us to bring us into eternity with him. So don't run away from that. And by the way, before you walk away from Jesus Christ, before you walk away from the church, ask yourself two questions. Why in the world would I walk away from a God with infinite love, who is omnipotent, who is omniscient, and who promised to work all things out for my good, and who is loving and has the ability to do it? Why would I walk away from that when all I have to do is wait? The second question is this. When you walk away from Jesus, when you walk away from the church, who are you going to? Where are you going? Where are you going when you get financial problems? Where are you going when you get relationship problems and can't get along with people in your family? Who are you going to? Where in the world are you going when you go to the doctor and he gives you a terrible diagnosis? Where are you going? You had to walk away from Christ. No need crawling back to him now. You could crawl back to him with repentance, of course, and he will always accept it. Sure you will. There's always hope as long as you want to do that. But where are you going when you walk away from the fellowship of Jesus Christ? The devil will welcome you with open arms. He always got his arms open. But remember, his job is to steal, kill, and destroy. The Jews did not understand that. They turned their back on Jesus a couple of days later after they holler, Hosanna and blessed, down this crucify and crucify. They turned away one of the greatest opportunities. And as I said earlier, they're still under judgment for that today. Still under judgment with another problem coming. There's one more thing else I want to say about... my time is running out here. Okay. Let me just say this and then I'll close out. Sometimes God gives us... God always leads us in what to pray about. The Holy Spirit leads us in what we should pray. I think I have a scripture here for that. And I skipped over a little bit earlier, but let me just run back to that for a moment. Okay. Let me just say this. The Holy Spirit leads us in what we should be praying. God uses his Holy Spirit because a lot of times we don't even know what to pray for. But because God is preparing us to bring us into eternity with him, he knows exactly what to give us to help us overcome a certain problem in our lives, to help us overcome a human shortcoming or an overwhelming habit that we may have. He knows precisely what we need. So he'll sometimes use the Holy Spirit to get us to pray for something that he was planning to give us in the first place. You'll find yourself praying for something that God was going to give to you. And God was going to give it to you because God is going to bring you a trial with it to test you and grow you up. And you'll find yourself praying for it, and sure enough, God will give you that blessing. With the blessing, here comes the trial to usher to testing. He's testing you. So he'll do that. Yes, you'll find yourself praying for things you never thought you were going to be praying for. But the Jews didn't understand any of this. They turned their back on God, and this was Palm Sunday when they did this. They welcomed him, and by Friday, Good Friday, which we will be celebrating here, as you heard in the announcements this Friday coming, and they turned their back on God, and it was one of the worst things they could do. What we learned from this is never to turn your back on God. Worst thing you could do in your life, you walk away from God, where are you going? who are you going to? So this was Palm Sunday, and this is when we celebrate and commemorate the life, death, and burial of resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And this is Holy Week, the first day of Holy Week. We're going to have a great time doing this week with millions or billions, I share, of other Christians, and also the heavenly hosts who are celebrating with us. Those are all the holy angels, Jesus Christ and God himself. So let us go before the throne of grace in prayer. Father in heaven, we humbly bow before your throne here this morning in the name, this afternoon in the name of Jesus. And we are so grateful that you blessed us and taught us what Palm Sunday is all about. We thank you for sending Jesus Christ as he entered Jerusalem on a donkey, Lord, declaring for the very first time officially that he's the Messiah and the King. We pray, Lord, that you will just help us to take this in our hands now, that Jesus is our Passover. He's our Passover lamb that has sacrificed everything for us. So we celebrate this time right along with our Jewish brothers as well. And we pray, Lord, that you will make this week a great week for us all as we commemorate what you have done for us. Thank you for the word, Lord. Thank you for blessing us. And we ask you to take this word, help us to take this word with us wherever we go and whatever we do, and help us to use it to glorify you and be a blessing to all whom you put into our way. We ask your blessings now on the offering, Lord. We know that you love cheerful givers. Help us to be cheerful givers, Lord, and bless us to use these funds to expand the kingdom of God, to reach others and to help bring others into relationship with Jesus Christ. We thank you, pray to you, and ask all this in the mighty name of Jesus. And we say amen.
Amen.